I don't think you can understand India or change India if you understand its inequality. And if you don't understand the inequalities uniquely found in India, until you understand caste, until you understand caste and gender, and we will be talking about both of these things tomorrow. Let me talk a little bit before we continue about this great debate between the two tallest figures in India's freedom struggle, Gandhi and Ambedkar. Recently, Arundhati Roy wrote an annotated introduction to Ambedkar's writings called The Doctor and the State Saint. And in it she actually presented a very fierce rejection of Gandhi's legacy. And this is in recent times become a great debate of Gandhi versus Ambedkar. Gandhi, in all of Gandhi's great legacy, Gandhi still lived with the imperfections of his time as any human being would. And his greatest failing, to my mind, is his defense of the idea of caste. Gandhi, for much of his lifetime, did not feel that caste in itself was a problematic institution. He felt that untouchability is a problematic institution. The treatment of people at the lowest rungs of the caste system as unclean and with a whole set of social disability, he felt was extremely wrong. But he separated it from the idea of caste itself. Whereas Ambedkar argued that untouchability is not a distortion of caste, it is intrinsic to the idea of caste. He very powerfully and compellingly fought against the idea of caste. He said caste is not, Gandhi said caste was a benign social system for the division of labor. He said that society needs to be organized into groups. Young children born into a particular caste learn the skills and the traits of that caste and so on. So he had a romanticized idea of caste. Whereas Ambedkar said caste is not a division of labor but a division of laborers in which certain groups of people are trapped in devalued work based on their present social status. It is a system which doesn't allow mobility. It is a system which says that where you are born will determine whether you will be allowed to study, what kind of education you can have, what kind of jobs, livelihood you can pursue, where you will live, etc., etc. And this debate actually continues until today. Ambedkar, in fact, was a great supporter of modernity, of industrialization, of capitalism, because he believed that these would give the only forms of escape to people who were Dalit. Whereas Gandhi was opposed to modernity. His Hind Swaraj is a classic is a classic treatise of it's actually written 100 years ago in its critique of Western civilization. It is still worth reading. So symbolically, Ambedkar was wearing a Western three-piece suit, whereas Gandhi chose to wear a symbolically a loincloth like the poor. Gandhi was a devout Hindu all his life, and we are told that when he was assassinated, the last words that he uttered was made out. Whereas Ambedkar said that I am born a Hindu, but I will not die a Hindu. And a few months before his death, he converted to Buddhism with millions of followers. I think there's no doubt about enormous literal presence and persistence of caste in rural India. In urban India, I would argue, caste has an idea continues to prevail. So the caste has, the idea of caste is basically that it is correct for your birth to determine your destiny. And in that sense, the absence of outrage that I talk about, when we accept a social, political, economic order where a person is born still continues to determine whether the child gets education, what kind of education, how far they can study, etc., etc., and what kind of jobs they can aspire to, continues to be part of our social reality in a much more and second, of course, the questions again, literally of marriage and so on, where most people who have arranged marriages have them within their caste, quite unconvenient. So I was sitting in my office one day, and I got this. Some people came and said that you're not being allowed to draw water from the village well, which is common practice. But they, at some point, an organizing said they wanted to assert against it. So I dropped everything and I went with them to the village and got a meeting, and I said that there's no way that you can stop them. It's against the law. It's against the constitution. And in my presence, I will make sure. So I made sure that the Dalits drew water from the well tank. I also drank some water and so on. And I went home thinking that my job was done. And there were no further complaints. Then some 3 months back, 3 months later, I was also driving by in a jeep, and I thought, let me just check what's happening in that village. I went in and I went to Dalit Basti. I called a meeting and I said, how are things going? Are you able to draw water from the well? So they said, yes. From that day, we were able to draw water from the well. But what? But from that day, the upper caste people stopped drawing water from the well. And it just illustrated to me that, you know, I can by law say you have to allow them to draw water from this well. But by law, I cannot say you have to also drink the same water. So you need the law, but you need a social reform movement before ultimate change will come about. With a group of some of the country's most well-known social scientists, I first decided to do the largest study that has been done about the practice of untouchability in India. And this was before this film was made, around the same time. And our findings were pretty much similar. Since you formed the film, I'll just quickly take you through some of the findings. That firstly, when we had non-Dalit researchers doing this research, they went to these schools and they said there's no discrimination. We've not encountered any discrimination. When we sent Dalit researchers from between a third to half the villages, they said there's serious discrimination against Dalit children. Why was it that we found such different outcomes in the same research? They went to the same school. Why do you think that we found such different outcomes? Anyone? Were the upper caste researchers being dishonest, for instance?
For them it was like, I think you talked about it earlier,
For them it was normalized. It was, you know, they saw the Dalit children sitting at the back. But they didn't think that it was discrimination. It didn't outrage you. You didn't notice it as discrimination. One of the biggest things that cities give is the possibility of an escape from your caste identity over time. Because caste in this one striking way is different from race. It's not written on your face. In a village, your identity is completely known. In a in a city, over time, over a few generations, once you acquire education, etc., you drop your surname, you can somehow pass it. But there are some occupations, like the scavenging community, the manual scavenging community, which is a community which whose duty is to clean toilets. And that's considered one of the lowest of the low. They have a really tragic situation in cities because the fact that they continue to do this work makes them segregated. And through that segregation, they have their identity is not known. And theoretically, I can leave that profession. But if I leave that profession, you know, the dilemma, and you need to understand that, if I'm born into a manual scavenging caste, economically, I'm actually more secure than most workers. Because I have the monopoly over a vocation that society cannot go without, and which nobody else is willing to do. Right? So, it makes me actually much more economically secure than most. But it makes me the most socially degraded. And I think that if you have to understand why caste is the longest unbroken system of discrimination. You know, all other systems of social discrimination have at some point of time led to a rebellion. Caste is the longest unbroken system of suppression of one group by the other, except one. Which is gender. Gender is the longest unbroken system of oppression in the world, across societies, across countries. The caste is, has continued for 2,000 years, and somewhere the complexity of this, that caste actually gives you a certain kind of economic security, while pushing you right at the bottom of the social ladder. And therefore, it's much harder to break out of. But what I was arguing is that, otherwise, marriage, the social relations, people retain their caste. One of India's well-known sociologists used a very interesting phrase: he studied factory workers. You wear a shirt when you go to work. So he said, when they put on their shirt, they take off their caste. But when they come home and they take off their shirt, they put on their caste. So in your personal life, it continues to be a dominating, defining feature, temple, whatever, worship, marriage. The city gives you some opportunities for dilution. Untouchability is linked to the notion of pollution and purity. And what is connected most with pollution is a lot of anxieties around death, corpses, around menstruation, around excreta. So any work that involves cleaning of or handling of any of these is considered, so people who have to pick up corpses of animals or dispose of dead bodies, the domes, for instance, work in cremation grounds. You saw the boy who was very angry about having to pick up. And how this persists is that the railways will, government employees across the country, people from the same community. The government continues to employ them to do these tasks. It is not as if, as I said, this has been a long, unbroken system, but there's never been no assertion. So we have had these periods of, the Bhakti movement, the Sikh, social reform movements, etc., have been through the centuries attempting to bring some kind of social equality. Gandhi was against untouchability, as I said, he wasn't against caste, but he did sleep in the scavenger bus, adopted a Harijan girl, and what for its time was a very radical movement was he started cleaning his own toilet, and that was considered very with gesture. One of the few times he had a big showdown violently with his wife, who maybe tried to force her to clean her toilet. But Babasaheb Ambedkar, who came from the Dalit communities himself, was a remarkable person. He was born in a Dalit home, very poor, and he struggled, but was extremely bright, and he ended up in Colombia and got his PhD from there, came back. And he led many agitations for social equality. One of them was simply to, he led a movement to go to a lake called the Jamnad Lake in Mahad in Maharashtra, just to drink water from that lake, and it became a great movement. And in his speech he said, it is not as if drinking the water of Jamnad Lake will make us immortal. We have survived well enough without drinking it. We are going to the lake to assert that we too are human beings like others. Babasaheb Ambedkar was given the responsibility in Free India to lead the writing of India's constitution. And that is why the constitution in India is deeply sensitive to issues of social inequality. There are many constitutional provisions. There's a provision on the restriction of access to public spaces, reservations which will come to, the abolition of untouchability, restriction in forced labor, right, protection of right to admission to educational institutions, and so on. There was a law passed called the Protection, it was Anti-Untouchability Act, which was later called the PCR, the Protection of Civil Rights Act, which made untouchability in religious places, shops, restaurants, etc. All of the things that you watch happening in the film are actually strongly debarred by law, but almost never implemented. And then in 1989, they actually had a new law, Anti-Atrocities, which looked at violent and more extreme forms of class discrimination as crimes, including sexual exploitation, etc., public humiliation, eviction, boycott, etc. But its implementation has been completely dismal, because the implementation machinery is run by people who are not convinced about this at all. And then there is the big question of reservations. As I said, it is something that we need to discuss, because it is for most people, non-Dalit people in this country, most young people, it is something that they very strongly are opposed to. India has the most ambitious program of affirmative action in the world, where there are reservations in all public offices, elected and appointed, and also in schools of higher technical education, medicine, engineering, so for people from socially disadvantaged background. This is something that over the years has caused an enormous degree of unhappiness. And sadly, over the last 20, 30 years, the times when students have actually come out to the streets and fought dramatic, visible battles have been in opposition to the idea of prejudice. There's an organization called Youth for Equality, which was constituted, which also is leading this very strong agitation. And at one point in the late 80s, early 90s, it became particularly emotive, particularly because one upper caste young man actually set himself on fire. All of you would have been very small at that time. But it became a very dramatic, iconic movement of opposition to the idea of resolution.